really pleased to have our opportunity to introduce our speaker. Dr. Fritz Engstrom is the chief medical officer at the Brattleboro Retreat. And I'm really happy to have Fritz here as our first speaker because I remember about 8 or 9 years ago, I called Fritz up and said, "Fritz, I have to teach abnormal psych this semester. What should I do?" And he said, "Oh, you should show them films." And I said, "Okay, sounds like a good idea." And he says, "I just happen to have written a book about how to use films to teach psychology." So I went out, I got the book, and designed my course. He also said, "Get a copy of the DSM," and that's going to change, but the films are still the same, so we can count on some things. So please welcome Fritz Engstrom.
Thank you, Ken. When I got done with my training in psychiatry, I started doing some teaching, and I realized how much of my teaching I hated. It was boring, boring, boring. And for someone with a fairly short attention span, it was death. So I saw a guy give a conference once in which he showed some clips. This is, believe it or not, before video cassettes existed. It was clearly the best way to teach. So one of the themes tonight is not really directly related to probably why you're here, but I firmly believe that if you choose some very brief scenes from movies, I think they're really, really appropriate for any teaching that involves kind of human relations or particularly emotions. And so I'm thinking not just of, say, psychology, psychiatry, but I think, for example, there's a lot of teaching on leadership. Well, there's a lot of stuff in movies about leadership. Or if you're teaching sociology, I think a lot of these fields, at least in my field, psychiatry, the way I always saw it, there's lots of jargon, and it was impenetrable. It wasn't just doctor-patient relationship. It was things like transference, counter-transference, projective identification, self-object. That was totally meaningless to me. But once I saw it and I started showing scenes, say, to medical doctors who would say, "Oh, Fritz, that talk you gave on depression, now that I saw that scene from last picture show, I have a better idea of what depression looks like," or panic attack from Midnight Run. So that, because most of us learn better seeing than hearing, not everyone, but certainly visual learning is a big part of everyone's life, and yet so much of my teaching was just talk, talk, talk. So I'm just going to just breeze through a few things tonight, and I welcome your questions. I'm good at kind of saying, "Okay, no more questions, we're going on to the next movie clip." So feel free to ask things, and I have all sorts of ways I can kind of configure these things. But what I thought of tonight was the theme is something like what it's like to be with someone with some emotional problems. And I use the term emotional problems. I'm using it as very, I don't want to label it as illnesses, psychiatric illnesses or disorders. And because these people and these things don't necessarily have illnesses, or even if they do, they're still people. And the question is what it's like to be with people who are having problems. And so that's kind of the theme, but obviously it's a very broad theme, and so we can go almost anywhere with it. So I have a few scenes pulled out that I think will be relevant to that. Just what it's like to be with someone who's having some emotional problems. And what I'd like to do then is start with, many of you have probably seen Mrs. Doubtfire. And I don't really need to introduce it much because this is the opening scene in the movie. And I'm just going to afterwards just talk about what would it be like to live with the Robin Williams character? Good, bad, and the ugly. And so this is Mrs. Doubtfire, came out several years ago. And the sound is not perfect. Figaro, Figaro, Figaro.
fígado, 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 fígado,
Salutation, Mac.
Death on the second boat.
Life!
911, 911, police, secret authorities, ASPC, ASAP, murder, betrayal, kidnap, no, burnout!
A cup of garlic, a twist of etiquette. Eat your heart out, Julia Child.
Excuse me. But isn't it customary for the jailbird to get one telephone call?
In your case, I think not. Afternoon snacks are very few civil liberties. But I'm not really without art. How about a nice, soothing cigarette?
What are you doing? Daniel, that line is not in the script. Why did you add it?
Well, I thought I should comment on the situation.
What situation?
The fact that Pudgy the Parrot has a cigarette shoved into his mouth is morally irresponsible.
This is a cartoon, okay? This is not a friggin' Oprah Winfrey special.
Lou, millions of kids see this cartoon. It's like sending each one of them a packet of cigarettes and saying, light up.
You can't put words in Pudgy's mouth if his mouth isn't moving.
Well, it's voiceover. It's an interior monologue. Maybe even the voice of God, that's even better.
Don't Pudgy, don't smoke.
Packers.
What? Well, let's ask the technicians. Do you think it's morally right to promote smoking to the youth of America?
They're biased. That's a mistrial.
Danny, listen to me. This session is costing the studio thousands of dollars. Now, if you want a paycheck, you stick to the script. If you want to play Gandhi, then do it on somebody else's time.
Then I've got to do what I've got to do.
That's very funny. Where the hell are you going? Hey, listen, buddy, I'll tell you something. If you leave, you're not coming back in. I'm not taking any crap from you, pal.
Well, in the words of Porky Pig,
piss off, Lou.
So what would it be like to live with a character like that played by Robin Williams? Say if he were a friend of yours, or if he is in your family, or he was a co-worker who you had to work with closely. What would it be like to live with someone like him? Yeah?
I think we'd get old pretty quick.
Old pretty quick. And when you say old pretty quick, can you elaborate what that means?
It would annoy me pretty quick.
Very annoying.
Yes.
Yes, back there.
I think it would make for a very awkward situation a lot of times. It would make me very introverted, seeing as how he's a very extroverted person.
Yeah, right. He wouldn't let you be quiet, and he'd be pretty intrusive, very intrusive. Any other thoughts? If you were, let's say he was a family member. Now, with adults, I say, what would it be like to be married to him or be partnered with him? But or even if he's a parent, what do you think it would look like in terms of reliable, bringing home the bacon, keeping a job? Yeah.
If you were like a romantic partner of some sort, I would feel like I would be like a mother, not a romantic partner, you know?
Yes, that you'd have to mother him, take care of him.
Yeah.
Because ultimately, he would be so annoying that he would make some bad choices. And that you'd have to kind of take care of him so that he wouldn't. And after mothering him for a long time, how do you think you'd feel?
Like I'd want a divorce.
Yeah. Yeah, and people, I think, like this probably get divorced more often than others. Yes.
In terms of bringing home like a paycheck.
Yep.
For him, it looked like that was a regular show, and like in any field, there's the higher pays and the lower pays, but some voice actors get paid a lot of money because the shows are really popular.
Right.
Some get paid less.
Yes, but he doesn't keep the regular job very long. And I think someone like this often, you know, will lose jobs and then gain jobs. And often people say, you know, if you'd only watch your mouth, you could go farther. So you could see the range of emotions. Someone like this, I always think of as, you know, is good for a party for an hour or two, and then it's like, oh, good, I don't have to live with them. But let's see what else we have here. Hold on just a second. I want to show a scene from a movie called Lone Star. Not too dissimilar. If you haven't seen this movie, it is a terrific film. John Sayles did a lot of independent films, and this is probably his masterpiece. He often is in the background. He's often cleaning up scripts for big-time movies that they are failing on. He's a very smart guy. But this is his own. It's kind of a long, complicated story. But suffice it to say, for this particular scene, it's in Texas. The sheriff is trying to figure out some family history because it's related to a murder. They found the bones of an old sheriff with a... that he's just trying to sort through. And so he goes to see his ex-wife, Bunny. And so here he is with Bunny because he wants to get some family records from the garage. And so here he is. This is the only scene of Bunny. And now, this Bunny's played by Frances McDormand. She was the sheriff in Fargo. She's a terrific actress. And she was in Almost Famous and several other of the Coen Brothers films. Anyway, so this is... again, think of what it's like to, you can even notice it in him, what it's like to be with her for any length of time. And this is Lone Star.
This time, Fred's video for Painter, and the Yanks jump to a 14-point lead. Late in second quarter, shooters back to punt on their own 27.
Longhorns are going to kick some serious butt this Saturday. You just watch.
You got a kid, a tailback from down your way, out of El Indio.
Well, that's in Maverick County.
Oh, right. And you're in?
In Rio.
Right. This kid, Jose Brown, he does the 40 in 3.4. Soft hands, lateral movement, the whole package. Only a sophomore.
So you still going to all the home games?
Best guys box in the stadium, and I'll fly to the Cowboy away games when they're in the conference. And then on Friday nights, there's high school, of course. Churchill's got this boy, 6'6", 310, moves like a cat. High school, we're talking. Guess how much he can bench press?
Buddy, you on that same medication?
What, I seem dumpy?
No, you look good. I just wondered.
Well, last year's awful rough, you know, with Mama passing on, and this whole business with OJ. I mean, it's not like it's Don Meredith or Roger Starbuck or one of our boys, but it kind of threw me for a loop.
Well, you look good.
And then there was that squeaker, the Aggies that dropped to Oklahoma on me, and that son of a bitch stepped in some lucky shit before he kicked that goal. And they hadn't pulled me off that woman, I would have jerked and not in her.
Well, you in a fight?
Well, Daddy calls it an altercation. How you doing, Sam? You look skinny.
No, I'm the same weight I always was.
Daddy hired a pinhead to take your job. Says himself, says he must have all been this pinhead I got now.
Buddy, that stuff I left in the garage still there.
At least he never called me back. With me, it was always high strung. My buddy would have done something with her life. She wasn't so high strung or tight and round. That's another one.
You haven't had one of your fires, have you? The stuff I left in the garage, some of it was my father's.
Did you watch the draft this year? Of course you didn't. Idiot question. They try to make it dramatic, like it's a big surprise who picks who in the first round. Only they've been going over it for months with their experts and their computers. doctor's reports, coach's evaluations, highlight reels, psychological profile. Okay. I wouldn't be surprised if they collected stool samples on these boys, had them analyzed. All that to pick a football player for your squad. Compared to that, what you know about a person when you get married to them doesn't amount to diddly, does it?
I suppose not.
You kind of bought yourself a pig in a poke, didn't you, Sam? That whole time that we were first seeing each other, you didn't know that I was tightly wound.
It wasn't just you, Bunny.
No, it wasn't, was it? You didn't exactly throw yourself into it heart and soul now, did you? Your shit's still in the garage, if that's what you can afford. £350. That boy Churchill's got. He plays tackle both ways. Bench press is £350. Imagine having that much weight on him. Press him down. Be hard to breathe, hard to swallow.
I think they have another fella there to keep it off your chest. A spark.
I only got my little girl now, he says. She's my lifeline. And he tells me I can't sit in the box anymore if I don't control myself. Some of a bitch didn't even watch a game. He just sits there drinking with his business friends. Looks up at the TV now, man. I'd be better off sitting in cheap seats with some real football people.
You're good, Bunny. It's nice to see you.
I like it when you say that, Sam.
So, living with Bunny, and you might have even noticed it in Sam. What was he like? Thoughts about what was it like to live with Bunny?
She had replaced reality with facts and figures from football. It must have been horribly, horribly irritating to never get a word in and have it deflected with some obscure fact that no one really cared about.
Yes, so hard to stay on a subject, always changing, hard to get a word in edgewise. Other thoughts related to that? Yes?
Well, this bugged me a little bit. She was wearing an Oilers hat and a Cowboys jersey. She doesn't really care about football or whatever team.
There's a wide variety of team logos.
Second of all, I think she had bipolar. She had a real manic depressive sort of state of mind. I don't know.
Right, you could see her going from tears to excitement within seconds.
She also went to a little bit of anger when she...
Yes. You can get your shit out of the garage.
The shit is still in the garage.
Right.
That's what you came for.
Right, so you could see her mood could change. And if you're around someone whose mood changes really fast, how do you feel?
Confused.
Intimidated, confused, anything else up back there? So confused, intimidated, I feel, and it's kind of like living with an alcoholic, you end up being anxious. You're on edge, you're wondering, what mood is she going to come home in? Is she going to be a good mood and want sex all night? Or is she going to be furious with me? Or is she going to be all over the map? Who knows what the mood is, but it's going to be, but I said sex because you notice how many times she referred to sex directly or indirectly. I mean, she was very, very... emotional, and being around him, I thought Sam was anxious around her. You know, he was kind of careful with his words. Didn't want to upset her. Looking good, Bunny. I like it how you say that, Sam. He knew how to calm her down. And I think it'd be exhausting being around her. You could even be afraid of violence because you heard about fires and about getting in a fight.
Kills you when you sleep.
Yes. Incidentally, I've shown that scene about 50 times, and it's only the second time anyone noticed that I had a psychiatrist say, I know she's bipolar because no one in Texas would have a Houston Oilers and the Dallas Cowboys at the same time. That just, you got to be out of it to do that in Texas. So that was number two. Nice going. Any other comments about, yeah? And I'm not saying she is bipolar. I mean, I think you need a much more careful evaluation. But that's the sort of thing you think about when you see someone like her. And I particularly, as a psychiatrist, it's kind of an aside. What we're taught to do is look at our feelings and look at ourselves. And so when I'm with someone and I find that I have to interrupt them to get a word in edgewise, that's usually a sign to me that they might have mania or bipolar. That the only way to get a word, to have a dialogue, you ask them questions that go on for hours practically, so you have to interrupt. So when I find myself interrupting others, I say to myself, is this bipolar? And that's just kind of how I kind of look at myself as I'm interviewing. Any other comments about Lone Star? Yes?
Just the way he, right before he left, he was backing away. You could tell that he just wanted to get out.
Right.
She was just going on about whatever she was talking about, and he just wanted to get out.
Right. And you know, again, that says a lot about being with people like this. You just want to get out.
Yeah.
Can you imagine what it was like trying to get out of the marriage? Yeah. World War III. Yeah.
Also knowing there's a bunch of like deer heads.
Yeah.
Just standing there for no reason.
Right.
And I mean, like the place that she would hang out, you know, was just organized chaos.
Right, and I think that says a lot about what her mind is like, which is, I don't even know about organized, but chaos. And of course, you notice a lot of pills and alcohol too. You know, it's all thrown in there. Yes.
That was in the kitchen. You notice that, like, I think at least one of them was already opened without any cap on it. So maybe she just took some, or maybe she forgot to take the medication earlier, or just simply never used it.
That's a very interesting point. There's a lot of research on whether people take their medicine as prescribed. Probably only about 70% of medicines taken as prescribed, and then and even that's kind of a generous definition of taking as prescribed. There's a lot of variability. So, as a doctor, you're always trying to figure out, do they really take the medicine? So, that was a good question. I want to talk a little bit about now going into A Beautiful Mind. Probably a lot of you saw this. This was about John Nash, who was a mathematician, but who also had schizophrenia. And I'm not going to dwell on the diagnosis, although I think it's probably the most accurate depiction of schizophrenia that I've seen in movies. Very powerful. And this particular scene may give you a pretty good picture of what it's like. To try to kind of guess what it's like to be around him and people with the sort of problems that he has. So this is A Beautiful Mind. I think it's Russell Crowe. So this one, what it shows is he's married and have a baby, and there's a storm, and his wife. It's a scary scene, but I have to tell you, nothing scary happens. But it feels scary just with what's going on. But it gives an idea of what it's like to be in his mind. And so again, I want you to think about what it's like to live with someone whose mind is like this. So a storm is coming, and his wife sees the shed out back. And she hasn't been in there a long time. So I thought it was a little longer than that. So just looking at that inside of that shed as a depiction of what his mind is like, arrows going everywhere. What were some of your reactions? What were, again, look partly just at your feelings, and but then your thoughts too as you saw that. Yes? She was terrified.
Yeah.
Did you feel terrified?
Yeah.
I know every time I see that, I get goosebumps.
Yeah.
I just thought, wow, what a mess of a mind.
Yeah.
It's like everything is all over the place, though. He had everything connected, so it's like the web of neurons going through the brain. That's how my brain pictured it. And then all these pictures all over the wall.
Yeah.
Just insanity.
Yeah, and probably scary for him too, yes.
I think what made it so funny is it wasn't just horror, it was horror of the great sadness. Of course, if you watch the movie in context, she only knew that he was schizophrenic. She understood that these delusions happened, but it was just this great pain mixed with anger.
Yeah, and I think in the movie, this is also her realization, he's actually been skipping his medicine.
Yes.
So it's interesting that it's not just how terrifying it is for her, but actually to him, the world is terrifying. He sees people after him, and he's scared all the time. Sometimes in the papers, you'll see someone, articles about people with psychosis, and I'm using that in a broad sense, but could be schizophrenia or other disorders, but who do violent things. But what you have to realize is most of the time it's because they're terrified. That they're terrified, and I'm not excusing it or justifying it, but just so you know the mindset. Yes?
The one thing I found interesting is that many of the papers that we saw in that account were war-related, and that retirements happen. So maybe he thinks that world powers and countries are trying to get after him through these wars. Maybe that's one thing.
Yes, and that's exactly right. And so, I mean, the term in DSM-IV is paranoid schizophrenic. People are paranoid. They really think that they are being attacked, hunted down. They're terrified. And in another scene, you'll see him talking about the military. Indeed, that's very common. And just to switch frames for a second, me as a psychiatrist, if I'm trying to figure out if someone has what we call delusions of false fixed ideas, it's very hard even to ask the question. Like I'll say, well, do you have crazy ideas? Well, no, this is reality. Or how do you think people treat you? Well, they treat me badly, but they really do. So it's very hard even to ask the questions because the part of the illness of bipolar and of schizophrenia is there's a long term, I'm even forgetting it, but in essence, you don't even know you're ill because your brain is affected, and so you don't have any perspective on what's going on in your brain. So it's a very difficult. Is there a question back here? Yeah.
It's like usually very rare cases in which the person is at least semi-aware of their illness or...
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And in fact, I was just looking at a website of a lot of people who are very high functioning, who have schizophrenia. It's a continuum. And I've worked with a lot of people over the years who are fully employed, who have serious mental disorders. They're limited, but they know how to take care of their illness, so it only minimally affects them. So the key is how to adapt properly. Did you have another comment?
No. So do they know without anyone else kind of telling them that they might have schizophrenia?
Well, I mean, these are things that are hard. As I say, part of the problem is people don't know that they're having a problem, but they may have some awareness. So these things are always continua. It's always somewhat unaware, somewhat aware, somewhat unaware. Difficulty forming relationships, it can form some relationships. So it's, you know, these things, we all have... some difficulties. Any other comments about Beautiful Mind? Let's go with Off the Map. This one is a little different. I'm going to show some other scenes that will be relevant to this. But Off the Map, I bet, has anyone here ever seen Off the Map, the movie? Oh, there are some. Okay, a very interesting independent film. This family lives, and correct me if I got this wrong. They live off the map, like in the desert of New Mexico or Arizona. And the narrator's this girl that you'll see in here. Maybe she's about 14 or so, and she says, "You know, this is the summer my dad was depressed." That's how the movie starts, and you see her dad just sitting there the whole movie. Doesn't talk. He's just depressed, or he'll say one word. And then his friend, who's in the house, his friend, since he won't go for help himself, the wife asks the friend to go to the VA and get some antidepressants. So the guy goes to the VA. First time he goes, she said, well, you got the antidepressants? He said, she just wanted to talk. But then the second time, or third, he finally brings home some antidepressants. And so they want him to take it so he'll get out of this terrible depression. So this has to do, the purpose of showing the scene is, really has to do with the whole idea of taking a medicine for your mental state. And all the positives and negatives and what it's like if you think someone might need one, or if you're the one. But it raises all the issues of what it's like, the psychological factors of just taking a medicine.
Take it, Dad, because we're going to sneak it into your food if you don't.
So he says things like, I don't like drugs, I don't care to. And what's his final objection? It's blue. And
there's all sorts of good reasons why people don't want to take drugs.
There are some better reasons than others, but let's just, I mean, it's not just side effects. It's, you know, taking a drug means I'm weak, I need help, it means I'm crazy, it means I'm sick, it means I'm addicted, who knows what it means. But let's look at it from the point of view of what it's like to live with someone. So here he is, very depressed. And I wrote down all the ways that the wife tried to convince him, and then the daughter tried to convince him. First she said, she pleaded with him, please try it. So what does that say? What's it like when you're with someone who you think really needs help and they're not accepting? Yes?
I had a question. They said they went to a lot of trouble. What does that mean?
A lot of trouble?
Yeah. Did they like get them immediately?
Practically. I mean, their friend who's sitting there, William, who's kind of sitting forward, he went to the doctor and said, I'm depressed, I need pills. And so he got the pills for himself, but then he gave it to him. So what's it like if you think someone needs help and they refuse it? Yeah. Uh-huh.
It is very hard because to try and get them to take steps to make them feel better, mm-hmm. especially when they're refusing it, is really hard. And if they keep refusing it, they make it harder and harder. How are you going to get some help if they keep refusing it?
Right. And so
you just end up with this feeling of despair and like, I give up. You can't end up with that.
I like that. What he's saying is you end up feeling in despair. I give up.
Especially like depression is contagious.
Right, and depression's contagious, so you end up feeling depressed. And, you know, in Alcoholics Anonymous, they talk about being powerless over alcohol or drugs, but in Al-Anon, which is for the family members, they talk about you being powerless to change the person who's drinking or using drugs. So you have to acknowledge you're powerless, and it's very hard. And he said it's contagious. That's a very important statement. Again, I'm not saying the only kind of treatment is pills. I'm using this as a metaphor for other things people may need. They may need therapy. They may need other things. But the person around them can get despairing. She says it helps depression, so she tried to be logical. That didn't work. She says, well, you're in a chemically altered state. Maybe a chemical will help you, so I'm trying to get more technical. She says, what have you got to lose? Because she knows how desperate it is.
Well, the daughter says, what have you got to lose, Dad?
Well, then, was that the daughter? Yeah, that's right. It's the daughter who said that. And then someone said, well, William takes it. In other words, the implication is maybe you think you have to be somehow deranged to take it, but William takes it. You see, William's okay. You're okay. It's not saying anything bad about you. Yeah.
My question is, especially in regards to a depression, I know that it's notoriously difficult to get people with bipolar and schizophrenia take medication. Schizophrenia, you lose the world around you. Bipolar, the hypomania can be an almost high.
Mm-hmm.
But is it equally difficult to get people with pure depressive disorders to go on medication?
Probably less so. People usually know they're depressed. Usually, with people, let's say with bipolar, when they're in a depressed state, they'll come for help. When they're in a manic or hypomanic state, much less likely, more likely the family will drag them in. It's in the old days, the antidepressants had a lot of side effects and they were dangerous, so there are a lot of reasons people didn't want to take them. Now they're fairly safe, but then they're overprescribed. You know, if people are depressed for good reason, because of all sorts of things, sometimes they're still prescribed medicine, even though that really misses the point. So sometimes it's so easy, it's almost too easy, but in general, people will come for help when they're depressed much more often. That's a great point. Interestingly, the two kind... Yes?
I'm not sure about that because I have friends who are depressed, and they don't for help. But if you think about it, when you're depressed, you basically give up on everything. And if you're depressed, why would you think, oh, I'm depressed, I'm going for help?
Well,
it's going to be like, I gave up.
Right.
I don't know more.
Absolutely. And so when I said that you're more likely to get help with depression, there are certainly a lot of times when people don't. People are so hopeless, you know, they don't want it. I mean, I've had people, very serious suicide attempts, and who when I see them in the hospital, they just say, you know, I really made a mistake. I shouldn't have called for help. I should have just let it go. My life is worthless. So it can be very despairing. If you want to see a grim documentary, it's called The Bridge. It's all about people who jumped off the Golden State Bridge, a few of whom survive, and some interviews with surviving family. But yeah, there's a lot of hopelessness, and people don't want to live because they feel their life is over. But finally, at the end, the wife says something like, we went to a lot of trouble. So she's finally talking about her feelings. She's saying, we went to trouble. This is exhausting me. This is tiring. This is trying. I feel despairing. And the daughter says, you know, you better take it because we're going to sneak it into your food, meaning, in a way, she's saying, we feel so badly for you, and we need you, that we'll do something that's even kind of tricky and sneaky and lousy. And finally, he takes it. So they actually talked about their own feelings some. I think that may have turned the trick in this particular case. Other thoughts about the scene? Well, let's see what we got here. Let's try About a Boy. This one, who saw About a Boy? I'd love to hear what you think. I just love this film. I thought it was very sweet, very funny. This boy lives with his mother, so the father's not in the picture. And I'll think of his name in a minute. And he's the narrator in this scene. And his mother is kind of like a Brattleboro mother. You know, she's kind of an earth mother. She has him wear all these knit clothes, and he's kind of a dork in school. And her son and some others go out for a picnic, and when they come back, the mother has taken an overdose, and they see her on the floor, and they don't dwell on that, but she obviously goes to the hospital for a few days and then comes home. So the beginning of the scene, you see the son is looking out the window, and he sees his mother and a mother's friend leaving the car to come up. So it's his first time he's seen his mother since her suicide attempt a few days ago. And they talk about it, and, you know, he's worried, you know, what if she does this again? And you can see how he takes care of things. So the purpose of looking at this is what it's like for him to live with a parent who's severely depressed. You know, what adjustments does he make? What sort of thoughts does he have? The way the movie, this is kind of a turning point in the movie, because he realizes she may kill herself someday, so he needs a second parent. So then he starts tracking down the character played by Hugh Grant, who's kind of a guy who likes to have no commitments. So, but this boy foists himself on the Hugh Grant character. It's very sweet. So think about what it's like to live with a parent with severe problems.
to during the part where I said I'd always love you.
It's a bit hard for you to love me when you're dead, isn't it?
I'm sorry. I can understand why you're angry, Marcus. But I don't feel the same as I did yesterday, if that's any help.
What? It's all just gone away? All that?
No, but at the moment, I feel better.
Well, home's no good to me. I can see you feel better at the moment. You just put the kettle on. What happens when you finish your tea? What happens when I go back to school? I can't be here to watch you all the time.
I know. We have to look after each other.
Suddenly I realised, two people isn't enough, you need a backup. If you're only two people, and someone drops off the edge, then you're on your own. Two isn't a large enough number, you need three at least.
Three what?
Nothing. I just had a great idea.
Darn, I still didn't catch it. What's his name again?
Marcus.
Marcus, thank you. But so how did, what did he do? How did he prepare for his mom coming home from the hospital? Yeah.
He was basically looking over the suicide letter.
Mm-hmm.
She came, he's basically questioning, like, you know, I'm not just going to blow this off like it didn't happen because it happened.
Right.
And so let's say it won't happen again. That kind of context.
Yeah, sometimes some people talk about various roles in the family. One role is truth teller, and Marcus is the truth teller. He's saying, you know, I can't just blow this off as a meaningless experience. And what did he do to the apartment and to himself before his mom came home?
Straighten it out.
Straighten it out, yeah. And why do you think he did that? Yeah.
Kind of show peace and stability.
Yep.
So, kind of like, you know, since she's going crazy, or like she's depressed and she wanted to kill herself because everything might be out of whack, and show like, you know, order.
Right, exactly. So he got the flowers, he got his hair combed, he's straightening his clothes, and he wants to do what he can to keep his mom from killing herself. So what does that do to Marcus? How does that affect Marcus then? What does that say about Marcus? Yes. Yeah?
Because if one person decides I'm leaving, then that leaves one person, you know, it could be the mom that leaves, and then what's he going to do? He can't, like, go out and really get a job and support himself. He'll probably end up in foster care.
Yep. Exactly, yes.
What you were saying about him, like, straightening out the house and trying to create a peaceful environment and stuff, I think it's him holding on to control, because if his mom kills herself, he loses all control of his life, and if he can in some way influence his mom not to kill herself, then maybe things will be okay, but, like, really it's something he has no control over. So I think that a lot of it has to do with, like, him trying to...
some control, even though ultimately it's not in control, and ultimately kids don't control their parents. Yes, back there.
Also at the same time, though, he wants to be a kid.
Yes.
He doesn't want to have to take care of her.
So what kid things is he sacrificing? By being the good kid, what's he giving up?
He has, like, doesn't have any friends.
Right.
That's why he's
yep.
around. He makes friends with
Hugh Grant character, whoever it is, yeah. Mm-hmm.
So he doesn't really kind of...
He doesn't dare express opinions about things that might disagree with his mother?
Yeah.
Because she might get upset? He doesn't have his own friends because then he's pulling away from his mother. She might feel lonely. Do kids also like to lip off to their parents when they're teenagers? Do you think he's going to try that?
Sure.
Probably not, because he's afraid she might go kill herself. You know, all the usual kind of being, trying out different roles of your own person might upset mom, so he's going to be a goody-goody, and meanwhile not even let himself think about other options. I just want to get her and I'll get you to you. Yes? Yeah. Yeah. Great point. Yep. Yes.
I noticed that he didn't like anything that can be harmful from that because I didn't see him put like I didn't see him put medicine ball in the bathroom and stuff like this. So I don't think he really got better.
Yeah.
Exactly. How I would have done it.
Yeah.
And also, I also noticed that he said, you know, like, oh, I'm fine. I know what happened. I didn't think so. I was going to do that. Everything. Do you really think that a depressed person would say, like, oh, I'm fine. But let's forget about it?
Yeah, I've seen that all the time.
Because in my mind, I would think that they would still be depressed.
Okay. Well, they are, but it's you know, I take, there's one study that shows about half the people who come into a psychiatric hospital because they're suicidal. The next morning, they say, I'm not suicidal. Yeah, they're still hurting. So you have to take it with a grain of salt. But it's interesting you say about, well, he didn't put away her pills, he didn't put away the knives. You know, again, that's a very interesting and controversial area. And I have very mixed feelings about it. On the one hand, we see, where I work, a lot of people who have attempted suicide. And we spend a lot of time talking to the family saying, well, you know, get rid of the guns or lock the guns up. You know, you control the pills, not the other person, et cetera, et cetera. But, you know, there's also a sense that ultimately, if someone really, really wants to die, there are lots of ways to do it. And ultimately, you can't control the person. On the other hand, you want to be serious about helping them to be safe. So it's without saying what you ought to do and ought not to do, it also reflects the fact that Marcus and people who live with those with, say, suicidal people are really in a tough spot because on the one hand, they want to keep the person safe. On the other hand, their whole life can be ruled by worries. Just imagine, let's say your mom or dad has tried to kill themselves a couple of times. Can you imagine walking home from school every day and every day thinking, oh my God, what am I going to find when I walk in the door? I mean, you know, that would be horror. Was there, yes?
It was very emotionally detached from like what just happened. She
right.
Wasn't even like next to the fact that her only son was that she tried to kill herself.
It is pretty common. I think what, you know, it's a very great question that kind of asked here is how common is it for people in one moment to attempt suicide and then the next moment or the next day say, well, you know, I'm not suicidal now and I said I loved you in the suicide note. It happens a lot, and one way of looking at it is, and there are many ways of looking at the idea of suicide, so bear in mind, this discussion could go on a long time, and it's very interesting, because one aspect of suicide is that, or suicide attempts, is that people are having a hard time communicating, hard time saying how terrible they feel, and that some people who are very depressed, most people never attempt suicide, partly because they're able to reach out to others. They can talk to others about how they're feeling, how sad, hurt, lonely, whatever. But I think when it comes to the actual suicide attempt, it's often people have a hard time communicating with people about it, articulating, I've been feeling terrible, I need your help, or I'm upset about this.
they have a hard time connecting, and when they attempt suicide, in a sense, that's their best way of communicating at that moment, which is, please, you know, will you finally realize how horrible I feel? And they sometimes, that's the only way, and so when they stop their attempt to suicide, like the next day, they're back to their usual self of having difficulty saying it. So part of my job as a psychiatrist is to say, well, wait a minute. I'm glad to hear you're not wanting to kill yourself today, but obviously you're feeling like shit. And let's talk about what was going on and what's it, because you're going to have other days when you're going to go downhill, but let's see if we can deal with the feelings in a different way, even though we know that they're very painful, but let's not go the suicide route. Interestingly, who commits in all of, almost in the entire world, Western Europe and the United States, who commits suicide more often, men or women? And how much more often? Five times more. Men commit suicide 4 to 5 times more often than women. Hold on. And so there's a lot of theories as to why that is. Maybe men choose more desperate means like guns, etc. But another, that only counts for part of. Part of it is, in general, men are rotten at communicating, at reaching out to people for help. And so they choose action rather than words. That's interesting idea. As I said, we can talk about suicide all day. Very interesting field. You had a question? You had a question.
Also, if you think about it, women most often share methods that aren't exactly direct.
As lethal.
Like they'll use poison over time.
Right. Yeah, and that's true, but as I said, the research seems to show that only accounts for part of the difference. So that was the other, that's half of it. Yes?
But isn't there a duality to that? Because, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but don't women also attempt more?
Yes.
Men just carry through.
Yes, exactly. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. So let's see if I can find another disc here. And let's see if I can get. So I wanted to go now to Lars and the Real Girl. Now, if anyone here has not seen Lars and the Real Girl, you really should. It's a terrific film. They didn't know how to market it, and so it was terrible marketing. But it is a wonderful film, and it sounds really goofy. Basically, Lars is a guy who kind of lives in this garage next door to his brother and sister-in-law. And his brother and sister-in-law, his sister-in-law is pregnant, and Lars works at some sort of computer place. And he's a loner. He's an isolated guy. And one day, someone at the computer place says, oh, you know, you can sell away, you can send away for these life-size dolls. Who's seen the movie? Yeah, I can see it smiling. Isn't it terrific? And you can, and the implication is you can send away for this life-size doll as a sex toy. That's the implication. But Lars gets a full-size plastic blow-up doll of a woman, and he names her Bianca. And for him, it's a real person. And it's not sex. It's a real companion. And he really enjoys Bianca. So this is the brother and sister-in-law taking Lars to the doctor to get help because he is doing such a weird thing. Ryan Gosling.
Midwest living or country?
Well, her blood pressure's low. Is that serious?
Could be.
We'll have to wait and see.
It's fine.
want you to bring her in every week for special treatment. Can you do that?
Yeah. Are you sure that that's necessary?
Yes. Set that up with Joanne, the desk.
Oh.
I look forward to getting to know you, Bianca.
Karen, I'm telling you, he belongs in a hospital.
No. Garth went to one of those places and he never came back.
Yeah, but he needs more help than you and I are able to give him.
I told you something was wrong and you wouldn't listen.
If I may. Has Lars been functioning? Does he go to work, wash, dress himself?
So far.
Has he had any violent episodes?
Oh, no. No, never. He's a sweetheart. He never even raises his voice.
Okay. We gotta fix him. Can you fix him?
I don't believe he's psychotic or schizophrenic. I don't think this is caused by genes or faulty wiring in the brain.
So then what the hell is going on then?
He appears to have a delusion.
A delusion? What the hell is he doing with a delusion, Professor?
We'll have to find out. Chances are he's been decompensating for some time.
I guess we didn't realize.
Have there been any changes in the family in the last year or so?
No, everything is pretty much exactly the same, except that Karen is pregnant and Lars is nuts.
You know, this isn't necessarily a bad thing. What we call mental illness isn't always just an illness. It can be a communication. It can be a way to work something out.
Fantastic. When will it be over?
When he doesn't need it anymore.
How can we help?
Go along with it.
Oh, no. No.
No, I mean, pretend that she's real? I'm not going to do it. I mean, I can't. I'm just not going to do it.
She is real.
Well.
She's right out there.
Right. I get that. But I'm just not going to, you know, I'm not going to do it. So.
You won't be able to change his mind anyway. Bianca's in town for a reason.
Right, but.
It's not really a choice.
Okay, all right, then we'll do it. Whatever it takes.
Oh, yeah, yeah,
yeah.
And everyone's gonna laugh at him. And you. She loves kids. And one of the best, I think it's a family physician, but one of the best depictions of a therapist or psychologist or doctor that you'll see in the movies. Yes?
Who are those, that man and that
woman? So the man is Lars's brother, and the woman is the brother's wife, the sister-in-law of Lars. And so what you see here in terms of living with Lars is, on the one hand, the brother's saying, he's nuts, fix him. So that's his way of looking at it. He's nuts, fix him. He has a delusion, get over it. And the doctor's saying something different. The doctor's saying, I look forward to getting to know you. You know, we have to find out, he'll keep it as long as he needs it. What she's saying is it's a communication that we need to understand. So that's, you see, two different ways of looking at it. We have to understand, he needs it for some reason, we're going to explore together, versus he's nuts, fix him. And it was very interesting, you can see how hard it is and how hard it's going to be for the family to just live with it. But in fact, that's how the movie, you know, unfolds itself, is trying to figure out what he's communicating, what his real difficulties are.
A few years ago, I saw a very interesting man in his 50s who started cutting himself a lot. Well, it's very unusual for men to do that, and particularly for men in that age to do it, and particularly men at that age to just start doing it. And people were saying, Fritz, could you come consult on this guy? There's something wrong. Is this a bipolar thing? And you know, they're looking at all sorts of weird diagnoses. And I went and interviewed him. And what was so interesting was that he, first of all, he was developmentally delayed, had fairly low IQ. He had been working for a long time in kind of a sheltered environment where he would greet people. And that place had just closed down. So he lost his whole identity. He really didn't have any other family. He had one cousin who was a drug addict who was using him to get some money and drugs. And he would try to connect with her. And she just was taking advantage of him. And it turns out this was really his only way of letting people know that his life wasn't working out anymore. He didn't have any people to look over him. And that he realized that if he cut himself, people would notice and maybe send him to a psych hospital, and he could start sorting out what he needed to do in his life. So it was just his communication, which was an odd one, but his communication, and then we got on track and helped him get what he needed to get. But instead of just sitting there with my book saying, well, he has this diagnosis and that diagnosis and this symptom and that, I listened to his story. And it didn't take very long. It was maybe at 20 minutes or a half hour. And the story made sense why he was doing it. And it was a communication kind of like Lars's, kind of an odd one. But it was the only way he could communicate. So that's kind of the interesting kind of parallel example I had of that. So what are thoughts about Lars and the Real Girl? Yes?
Actually, it's a question. What does it take for someone to trigger some of these illusions in a way?
It's very hard to say. I'd say I've never seen a patient like Lars, so I don't want to even pretend that it's a... Yeah. But, I mean, commonly people have delusions in what we diagnose as schizophrenia and sometimes in mania or severe depression. And from a chemical point of view, probably a lot of a dopamine at a receptor. But you can get it with drugs, you can get it with various other neurologic problems. It's a variety of things can cause it. Yes?
Are people who are having delusions in any way aware that
it's possible to be a delusion? No, my dad was a doctor. He's a medical doctor, an endocrinologist. And he wasn't interested in psychiatry, but for some reason, he would say to me and my sisters when we were little kids, remember, a delusion is a false, fixed belief. So it's not just a false belief, like in this case that Bianca's real, but it's fixed. You can't talk them out of it. Although in this particular case, as I said, this is fiction. I've never seen an illness like this. But what was beautiful about this is in this case it was fixed until he figured out what was behind it. Then he didn't need it anymore. But usually people with delusions, you try to argue them out of it, you're going to not get anywhere. Other people will be mad at you and just blow you off. So it's hard to be with someone and not challenge their delusions, but on the other hand, to understand them. That's really hard. Yes?
So I'm just wondering, a lot of times when people have this sort of like fake girlfriend sort of doll thing, like sometimes delusion like that, the answer doesn't always get help. Like, that's always the answer. But what makes it, like, I know, like, a delusion like that is, like, really weird, difficult to translate, and all that. But, what if it's, like, not as bad as
right. Well, I think. Like let me try to answer that. I think. Yeah. Well, first of all, having imaginary friends is common at very young ages, 4, 5, 6, in that area. Also, it's a great point, which is, what's wrong with having a delusion? And a lot of people, you can never force anyone to get into treatment for a delusion, unless the delusion is causing you to do something you know, dangerous to others or yourself. But, you know, you can just live with it. But so it's, you know, it happens all the time. I want to show one last scene, unless other comments about this one before we go to the last one? Or anything else on this theme? Pardon?
You go to the Juno one?
Oh, the Juno one. I wasn't going to. I love Juno. I just saw it again for the second time.
I've never seen it.
Oh, you should have seen it.
It's the only movie that I recognize.
Oh, yeah. Well, Juno's wonderful. This one, it really doesn't fit this theme, so I wasn't going to show it tonight. I'm sorry. But what I want to show is... you can see why I love teaching this, because a lot of the scenes are just terrific scenes. I want to end this with, I don't know if there's a Coen brother movie called Burn After Reading. And this too has Frances McDormand, whom we saw in Lone Star a few minutes ago. And it's a wacky plot, but there's a CIA guy in there, and there's a Linda Liskey, who's in the gym and always worried about her figure and everything, and people get killed and everything else, and this is the last scene, and I've edited this scene because when I show it elsewhere, I have to watch my language, so you can kind of guess what some of the seven things I've deleted from it, but it's a good way to end tonight because it helps us look at kind of what we've learned, and I think the guy, the CIA director here, is the guy that we saw in Off the Map. He was the friend who was just sitting on the chair leaning forward. He doesn't talk. He's the friend who got the medicine. So this is Burn After Reading, the last scene in the movie.
Wait a minute. Where is the Treasury guy? Farrer?
Right now. He is in a detention room worse than Dulles.
Why?
He's trying to board a flight to Venezuela. We had his name on a hot list. CBP pulled him in. Don't know why he was trying to go to Venezuela.
You don't know?
No, sir.
We have no extradition with Venezuela.
Oh. So what should we do with it?
Put him on the next flight to Venezuela.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Okay, so the gym manager is dead.
Yes.
The body is?
That's gone, sir.
Okay.
But there was a snag.
What?
Well, this analyst Cox was attacking the gym guy. It was in broad daylight on the street. Our man did not know what to do, felt he had to step in.
Yes.
He shot the analyst. He shot Cox.
Good. He's dead?
No, he's in a coma. they're pretty sure that there's no brain function.
Okay. If he wakes up, we'll worry about it then. So that's it then. No one else really knows anything.
Okay. Well, sir, there is...
What? What?
There is the woman, the gym woman, Linda Liskey.
No. Where is she?
Oh, we picked her up. We have her.
We have her? To do what with?
She says she'll play ball if we pay for some, I know this sounds odd, some surgeries that she wants, cosmetic surgery. She says she'll sit on everything.
How much?
There were several procedures altogether.
Pay it.
Yes.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
What did we learn, Palmer?
I don't know, sir.
Not gonna know either. I guess we learned not to do it again.
Yes, sir.
If I know what we did.
Yes, sir. It's hard to say.
Jesus Christ. treasury got caught.
I could watch that again and again. So what did we learn? I don't know. But it sure was fun. Thanks, everyone.